Hi, welcome to the show. We are the NJ Discover TV show, and we're really happy to have you all back. You can see us on njdiscover.com live right now, or YouTube channel, or you may be watching on some of the channels we have in our local Monmouth County, Mercer County, Middlesex County. So we want to wave to people from Long Branch, Marlborough, Old Bridge, North Brunswick, Princeton TV, yourtowntube.com, and Rutgers University Television. Welcome to the show. And I'd like to introduce Calvin Schwartz, my co-host and man of the hour, Rutgers fan. And here we are again.
Yes, we're back. I got to quote Ed Sullivan. We were just talking about him. This is a really big show. And I have to say, part of my monologue, you know, my Johnny Carson monologue, is how this all came about, and I'm going to say this quickly. But before I do that, I just have to acknowledge some special guests. Firstly, we have Adriana Alfonso, Assistant Dean at the Graduate School of Rutgers Newark. A long story, but and we have several Rutgers communication students from Newark and New Brunswick. So this is a learning experience and a bonding experience. And that's part of our studio audience. So back to how this all came about. It was a year ago at the Garden State Film Festival, and I had met Keith somewhere, somehow, and our little bond was Rutgers. We shared that, and I'll leave it at that. And he's laughing. I'll leave it at that. But I met Keith, and life's so funny how these things happen. So Keith said, you really need to meet a really good friend of mine. He's a great film director and filmmaker, Tom Ryan. So Tom and I, we met, and we talked, and we took a picture in the in convention hall hallway.
That's right.
A little mini ball. Yeah. And we talked a little bit, and I was enthralled with your work. And then literally three, and you were there. You were kind of, you were doing stuff on assignment for NJ Discover. Mm-hmm. So I'm just roaming around pretending I'm important. And a few minutes later, a young woman comes over to me and starts talking, and it's Stephanie Angel. And Stephanie starts telling me about Angelight Films and some of the things you're doing, and it kind of blew me away. And at that moment, in time, I knew we had to do this. So step two, after meeting you guys, because it was so fascinating, step two was to actually do NJ Discover a couple hours here, a couple hours there, and
forever.
A full day there.
I can talk.
A full day. Even the birds left. I mean, it was a long day. And after that, you know, the epiphany light bulb goes off, and I said, gosh, what a great show, and I talked to you about it, and we decided this is it's just like perfect. It's all, you know, cosmic meant to be. So anyway, that's how this came about. It was, this is the byproduct of a year of machinations. It's a great word, you know. I looked it up. Machinations, whatever. So also part of my monologue, I just wanted to mention that, you know, I'm writing my second novel, which is my life's work.
I'm so excited about that.
And I'm looking at CC back there. I call him CC just for
that's
for
a good way.
But last night, I actually wrote, I actually got up to that point in the novel. Fictionally, I wrote you in deeply.
Ah.
And I wrote CC in as well. Changing names around and protecting.
Oh, change my name.
Oh, it's all changed around, but you know who you are. But anyway, I did that last night. And finally, the last part of my monologue, and then we're going to jump right in. As I do one of your favorite segments, and you always say, please do it. So I do a segment that's literally 1 second long, things that scare the hell out of me. And I posted an article on my Facebook page about a New York Times article. See, I read the Times, by the way, from time to time.
Impressive.
I read the Times. But anyway, it was one of it really scared the hell out of me about super germs and how they're entering our society and how it's been kept quiet. And it scared the hell out of me. And if you want to read it, go to my Facebook page, and it's promptly there. And nobody read it. I get a kick out of that because nobody read it. It's there, and it's New York Times headlines. And anyway, that's it.
It's scary.
We have too much to do.
We won't comment on that.
We have too much to do, so I want to introduce, because I've been waiting a year to do this. Keith Armonaitis, Tom Ryan, Stephanie Angel, if you guys would just do a quick little bio to kind of set the stage.
Yeah, sure. So
Keith Armonaitis. Yes, I'm a Rutgers grad, went to Mason Grove School of the Arts for acting, and kind of got diverted after trying to make it in acting and doing stand-up comedy for a couple of years. Made $0. It was fantastic. But the, you know, what happens is whenever you kind of push down a passion, it pops out in some other way. So I started screenwriting about 20 years ago. Had a few films that were, a few screenplays that were optioned. Actually the president of the New Jersey Screenwriters Association. But, you know, the whole thing is that you go out, you option a script, it doesn't get made. You know, you don't get to see people actually using your words. And so I started looking more and more to independent film. Met some great people, such as Tom. Just by looking by example of what people are doing in the homegrown filmmaking industry, started to really work towards doing that. Have three films that have been produced so far. Two of them were actually directed by my Dutch brother, as I call him, Folke Barson. And then I had my directorial debut this past year with Be Home Soon, starring Heather Britton O'Scanlan.
So, nice. Yeah, so similar to Keith, I went to Jersey City State College, now New Jersey State University, New Jersey City University. Studied the media arts for a couple of years, ran out of tuition money, had to get a job and start working for a living. I fell into customs brokerage and imports and exports, been doing that my whole life. I actually work for a trucking outfit now as a sales rep. I've always wanted to be a film director. I've always loved film. I'm also a musician. Used to draw my own comics. I'm some of it an artist as well. And I probably got involved in independent filmmaking probably about 9 years ago. Was inspired by the advances of technology and how we are now able to edit, shoot, and score films basically from the comfort of your own home. It's become a less expensive prospect and something that's more open to artists everywhere. Much like Keith, I got involved with some other people's projects. I was inspired by the creativity, by what's possible now. So since then, I've made 6 short films and a feature film. 4 of my short films are combined for a feature anthology called The Theater of Terror, which is also the name of my independent production company. We're out there promoting it now. It's on the film festival circuit, and actually this summer we're going to be appearing at a lot of local arts and crafts film arts and crafts fairs. Hoboken, New Jersey, Garwood, New Jersey. We've already done one in Bloomfield. We'll be doing one in Jersey City as well, and then we'll be at the Monster Mania convention down in Maryland. That's a valley, yeah. But so that's what we're doing right now, and that's a little bit about me.
Hi, I'm Stephanie Angel. I went to Muhlenberg College, and I had self-designed 2 majors in film expression and spiritual thought because I wanted to do something meaningful with film. And in the summers in college, I would intern on film sets. My first film was The Believer with Ryan Gosling, and I just fell in love with the film set. I was like, I have to do this. I have to be on set. And then I worked on a TV show, 100 Center Street, and then my last semester in college, I finished a little bit early, and I went out to Spain on the Bridge of San Luis Rey, and I trained with the script supervisor, Diana Dill. And the director, Mary McGugian, she was a female director as well, and I learned a lot from that experience. So I came back after college, and I got my first job as a script supervisor on an independent film. I started working on features, TV shows, commercials for about 15 years as a script supervisor. And then in 2009, I decided I wanted to start my own nonprofit called Angelight Films. And I make short films for kids that have brain tumors. So we kind of co-create the film together. It could be about whatever they want, a music video, a documentary, a narrative. And it's like their chance to shine. It's sort of like film therapy. So they get to make the film whatever they want it to be about. And so far I've directed 11 films with Angelight. And I brought on recently Wendy Lobel to direct a film, which was in the Garden State Film Festival, where I received the Broader Vision Award for Greater Good in Film, where we met. And then the most recent film is actually directed by Amir Arison from The Blacklist. And we formed a production company together called Willmohr Street Productions. And we're co-creating a documentary, which is actually following the process of making the most recent Angelight film, which he directed. So it's really amazing because these kids have been through so much, and they're doing well. Like, statistically, it's interesting because their health has improved throughout the process of making the film. And so this one girl, Tatianna, her mom is a single mom of four girls, and so we're tracking the whole process of not only making her film, but her health along the way, and what it's like for a family to go through, you know, something that's often seen as a victim and so devastating, which it is very challenging and hard, but there's also all these ups and downs, and so we're tracking the whole process. So I have Angelight Films, and then Willmohr Street Productions is for this documentary.
Okay.
Wow. Very right. Accomplished group of people in here.
We talk a good game, that's for sure.
This is just so rewarding to do this. I've been, you know, so emotional about this. So let's start.
Yeah, well, I just think that it's so interesting how all of you kind of have evolved through your life. A lot of people, you know, they come out of college, they get a job, they stay in that industry, and that's it. But you all kind of changed a little bit. So we'll start with Keith.
Okay.
And so you started out as an actor and then into filmmaking. Is there someone who inspired you or
for filmmaking?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, well, it's kind of strange because when I'd kind of gone through, you know, trying to make it as an actor, spent a lot of time, you know, auditioning, and, you know, I actually saw the way that most actors are treated, which is like, you know, chattel. And so when I was kind of disheartened by that, kind of sullied me on it. So I went into stand-up comedy because I thought it would be better. I don't know exactly what I was thinking there, but it was a great learning experience because you learn to think on your feet, you learn how to interact with people, you learn how to read people, which is really important. And then, you know, my other passion is IT, which is, I don't know, I'm a kind of a left brain, right brain person. So it's like, so I went into that as something that, you know, became my career for many years, you know, put food on the table and, you know, put a roof over my head. but what happens is you always have that desire to create in the back of your head. And as I was saying before, it kind of pushes you, you know, to come out. So some people, they go into community theater, or, you know, they do something that's kind of tangentially in the arts. And what had happened for me was I just started writing. And so one of the things that had kind of piqued my interest was this idea that, you know, the second chapter of your life is whatever you decide to make it. So, like, Robert Heinlein, when I was a kid was my favorite science fiction author, didn't publish his first book until he was 40. And so here I was coming up on my on my 30s, you know, my mid-30s, and I said, you know what? I go, let's write a film, you know, let's just write a screenplay. So I wrote a screenplay that was not good, but everything starts somewhere, right? Yeah. And the whole thing is, as long as you keep working at something, you will get better. And so over time, I got really good at writing scripts. I got very good at pitching them. I had things that were optioned, and I realized that just because you option something, you know, you could buy a cup of coffee on what they'll give an unproduced screenwriter. I realized that if I really wanted to do something, if I really wanted to make my mark, I would have to go and do it myself, which is, it's kind of been my mantra my entire life. And so, you know, I know a lot of people that they think that they can have their immortality by passing the mantle on to their children. And I think that's unfair. You know, I wanted to do something that would live outside of, you know, my ability to procreate, right? I wanted to have something that somebody somewhere, maybe 100 years from now, if we're still around, they're looking at their version of whatever YouTube is, and they come across Mist or Be Home Soon or Swung, and they go, wow, that was kind of cute, or that was funny, or that was meaningful. And they go, oh, I wonder who that guy was, you know? So that was my inspiration.
I like that.
So, yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
Okay. Keith.
Yeah. Calvin.
Keith. So Talk about the statement, the power of film to bring around social change, social justice, those kind of things, because that, as I've seen, is an ingredient in your work. And then, this is a big question, and then talk about your work, some of the things that appeared in the Garden State Film Festival, and I don't know if we mentioned, but you won two awards.
Yeah.
Last week at the Garden State Film Festival.
And
talk about that.
Thank you.
And talk about Be Home Soon. So, talk.
Yeah, so basically, ever since I was a kid, I've kind of been involved in some form of politics. My mom, when I think I was like 7 or 8, my mom worked for a senatorial campaign, and she brought me in and started stuffing envelopes, and I was like, wow, what's this all about? And like some guy walked in and everybody went crazy. I'm like, who are you? You know, and it was the candidate, you know, so, you know, it was an interesting thing to see, but you really have to want to be in that world in order to see that piece of it. Just like any type of social justice issue. I have a very good friend of mine that, you know, is trying to stop the bear hunt. Well, you know what? If you're not into saving bears, or if you're not a hunter, that doesn't touch your life. But the thing is, there's a commonality in all of the things that people do when they're investigating social justice, is that they're trying to affect change at a grand level. And it's, especially if you're going against some type of thing that's a governmental in nature or big business in nature, it's really David and Goliath. But the thing is, especially nowadays, things are so polarized that if you want to point out something, it's a knee-jerk reaction where everyone's like, no, I, you know, this is what I believe, and you know, there's no hearing what's going on. And so the difference is in film, or in TV shows, or in books, or in any type of art, which is what happens is people, you could actually not beat people over the head with the message, but you could put the message in the film and present it in a way that it's, yes, it's entertainment, but it also becomes kind of a softer, gentler way to say, hey, here's the other perspective that maybe you didn't see. So my first film, Mist, is about a father and a son and the dangers of ideology and how it keeps people apart, even when it's someone that you love. Be Home Soon is really an investigation into what it's like to live the life of a woman that's being abused. Swung, which is my comedy, which I won the Lou Costello Comedy Award for, you know, that's really about senior independence, you know, and the idea that just because somebody's your mother, it doesn't mean that she has to subvert her life for you at all points in her life, even after you've moved out and your wife has kicked you out of the house. So a lot of that comes directly from the type of people that I enjoyed. So Kurt Vonnegut, I know is big you're a big fan of. I'm a big fan of him as well. I mean, Slaughterhouse-Five was really his way of kind of working through his demons, but also bringing to light social justice. Rod Serling is actually one of my personal inspirations when it comes to writing, because even if you look at all the Twilight Zones that he wrote, I mean, he wrote, I think it was like 65% of them. You look at those stories, each one is a morality tale in and of itself.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I never thought about it that way. I love Twilight Zone.
Yeah, great. All right, let's jump to Stephanie.
Oh, Stephanie. Congratulations, by the way. She's pregnant, if anyone hasn't noticed. Having a baby soon. Okay. So, Stephanie, so you kind of had a big, I don't know, it just seems like you did so many different things. You had so many great opportunities. Where do you think it started that you wanted to go into film and filmmaking? And, like, at what point, or did someone inspire you to get to that point to do the films that you do?
I think for me it really started with writing. I loved writing since I was a little kid. I had a sister that had passed away when I was a kid. I was 7 and she was 5. And I think my way of processing a lot of things in life was just writing. I would journal and I would just start writing, and then I would like automatic write, and I would start coming up with these ideas for stories. And I think it was when I was 14, I actually found a journal recently, and I said, when I get older, I want to direct what I write. I want to make movies, and I want to make movies from books, and I want to write movies. And there was this one night, I was just up all night, and I had this like idea where there was this world, and it was like not an ideal world, and then there was this, it was very futuristic, and I wrote it all down, and I said, one day this is going to be a movie. So it's, I did end up writing it, which I've been writing and rewriting for about 14 years now. And yeah, so I think my writing and my inner like inspiration that I would have was what really led me to want to direct and write.
And so your writing has a lot of personal feelings and emotions in it. And so when you're creating these films and these mm-hmm. stories and these ideas in your journal, you're really putting yourself out there. Do you ever worry about people judging you, or is it just that you want to inspire people? Or, I mean,
that's probably why they're not out there yet. But mm-hmm. I am done with that. I'm ready to put them out there now.
So
but
there
yeah, I think there's a lot of personal stories and experiences in there. So I think I did kind of keep it close to home for a while. Mm-hmm. But I do want to, my purpose of writing them was ultimately to share with the world. So.
And sometimes those are the best stories to hear mm-hmm. and to watch. So I'm excited for what you're going to do.
Thank you.
Okay, you touched on some Angelight films. If you can, this is so substantive in your life. So if a few other things you want to say about Angelight films, the origins, some of the specific. I saw a bunch of your, I saw a bunch of your films, and you talk about a little bit more about your collaboration with Amir Arison from Blacklist.
Yeah, so I think initially I had this idea. My family had started the Children's Brain Tumor Foundation, which is more of a research-based foundation.
For your sister Ilana?
Yeah, in memory of my sister Ilana. When she was sick, there wasn't a lot of resources or research at the time, so they started that when I was a kid. And I remember going to events, like they had the Big Apple Circus and different things, and I would meet more kids that had brain tumors, and I just saw there was this wisdom in them, and they've been through so much at such a young age, but they're not victims. Like, they're very strong people. And I thought, at the time, I remember thinking, I want to do something with film because I work in film and I want to do something with the kids, but I don't know what or how to tie them together. But I always had this feeling since I was very young that I wanted to do something important one day. I just didn't know what it was. And I was speaking with a social worker from the Children's Brain Tumor Foundation. And I said, maybe I'll make some short films for kids that are sick and maybe it will like help them or something. And I was like, but I don't even know what I would make them about. Like, what would I write? I don't know. And then all of a sudden, it was like a light bulb went off, and I said, no, the kids have to make the films, and I have to make them, like, make them happen, whatever their vision is. And that's when the social worker was like, yes, do it. You got to do it. No one else is doing this. So I said, okay, this is something unique that I could do that I feel is important. And so she connected me with three kids. And the first three kids were Lily, Colin, and Kyle. And I met with them, and I just got to know them. I met with them three or four times, just like sort of like similar to when we go over to your home and we're talking, and I just got to know them. And then once I knew who they were, I started to see what can I bring out about their film? What's their story? What do they want to tell? And so what's fun is, I work on so many commercials and TV shows where everything's scripted and pre-planned. And these kids get to create whatever they want. So it's really fun just to see what they come up with, unfiltered. And then luckily I work with a lot of great filmmakers, and so I was able to bring on people I worked with on set to help shoot and edit these films for the girls and the boys. And they inspire me, and I learn so much from them. And whenever I work on these films, it shifts my perspective, and all the filmmakers that work on it say, I usually feel tired after a long day of shooting, but I just feel so inspired because of these kids, because they've been through so much and they're so positive. And I think we have a lot to learn from them. So I said, okay, let me make a few more, see if this works, make sure it works, and it did work. And then I'm like, okay, now the last couple of years, I said, I have a 2.5-year-old as well, and I said, I can't direct them all myself. I want this to become bigger than me. I want to bring on more directors and producers. And so that's what led to me working with Amir, yeah. And when I sat down, I met with him, I told him a little bit about my process and how we were going to go about it. He said, have you ever documented the entire process of making a film? And I said, no, we capture a little behind the scenes here and there. He's like, I want to direct the film, but what I really want to do is direct this whole process.
The whole process. Mm.
Because that's where the magic is, from the pre-production meetings to the
meeting with
filming
the mother
to the screening.
And just
see like the inside life. Because how often do you see, you know, things in hospitals? You know, a lot of it's, the advertising is angled from more of a fear and victim standpoint, and you feel sad and then you donate money, but you don't often get to see it from the child's perspective or from the family's perspective of what they're really going through. And it's not all sad. It's birthday parties, Christmas celebrations, you know, vacation, like all these little moments that you don't really get to see, so that's what we're capturing.
Okay. That's great.
Tom Ryan.
Yes.
Tom Ryan.
That's me.
Ryan.
Okay.
I just thought I'd mention that.
Now, you have an interesting life, and you're saying you truck? Are you doing a truck driving?
No, no. I sell trucking services.
Very interesting. Yeah. All right. So everybody has something else on the side, but your big, you're into, what is it called? Theater of Terror?
Theater of Terror,
so
yeah.
How did that come? You seem like a very normal, nice guy.
Yeah.
So where did this idea of Theater of Terror come from?
Well, it's a long story, but I'll try to keep it short. Growing up, when I did in the late 70s and the early 80s, I feel like I was exposed to a lot of very classic films, and from horror to action to dramatic pieces that are just staples in society now and just well-known films. I was always influenced by those. I was influenced from everything from movies to comic books to television shows to music. I guess I didn't really know what I wanted to do. I am a musician. I dabbled in that at a very young age. We started out making films in the backyards with VHS cameras, like a lot of young filmmakers did. And unfortunately, the technology was not really at a point where we could do what we're doing today. You couldn't really edit VHS films besides hitting stop and rewind and shooting it again. So that passion kind of was transferred into my drawings and comic books, and I would draw movies I couldn't make. And I think that was kind of a dual script writing kind of lesson as well. I used to draw them and write the stories and color them, and it was just that whole process kind of got funneled into that. And then from time to time, I would get more involved into music. And I think I was just, I leaned towards being a creative person and just the arts in general. I loved all of it. I love sculpting as well. I just can't get enough of it. But real life took over, and unfortunately, I have to work for a living like most people and pay the bills and do something that pays those bills and take care of my family and my children as well. But I was given the opportunity to see the advancements in technology and what you can do now with digital cameras and what you could do with software at home, editing software. And social media actually brings the community a lot closer, so you find actors and you find camera operators and you find lighting technicians and you find makeup artists, and you realize there's a lot more of these people that exist outside of Hollywood than you would think. So getting in touch with those people, I found myself on an indie film set in about 2009, first as a makeup artist, and then I quickly became an actor, and which I'd done in school and plays and stuff on a very amateur level, but I started acting, and I was really influenced by what I saw around me and just the prospects of what could be done with the advancements. And so I dove back into that, and the Theater of Terror, the title, was actually born of something we used to shoot on VHS camera. Some friends and I, it was kind of like a Masterpiece Theater parody, where we would sit around and talk about these four movie trailers that we'd put together and review them. When I did get back into filmmaking, it was only right that I kind of hearkened back to those days where we were really being at our top creative levels then. And I called the company the Theater of Terror, and decided that we were going to start making our own horror films. I do love horror. I'm drawn to it. I think the horror genre is a great genre where you could touch on so many things as far as social justice. You could tap into fantasy. You could tap into creative special effects. And I just find there's so many things you can do with the horror genre that you might not be able to do in comedy or in drama, or it's a genre that I'm drawn to. I'm having a great time in that community. There's a lot of people. The horror genre really attracts a lot of people from a lot of different walks of life. So it's really a great community that's been very supportive of my work, and it's been a learning process for me. But I've gotten a lot of support from them, and I really tend to focus a lot on characters and character studies and compelling stories. And I write as well. I direct, I produce. Sometimes I'll act in these projects. I've operated the camera. I've done special effects for our projects. I'm really a hands-on person when I'm on set, and I enjoy the entire process from A to Z. Pre-production, as you mentioned as well, I love that the entire planning process of it. And so we've grown a lot, and I've learned a lot from it. And from what we hear from our supporters and our fans, they really like the types of projects that we put out. And to mention back to what you said about The Twilight Zone, I'm very inspired by Rod Serling and The Twilight Zone and that kind of writing. And I feel that those stories with a moral message behind them could be just as disturbing as the scariest monster that you could put on stage. Humans are really the scariest monster out there. And so things like The Twilight Zone or Tales from the Crypt, Stephen King's, I just relate very heavily to a lot of that type of storytelling. That's what drew me to it.
Yeah. Diverse group here.
Our studio audience and our audience out there appreciate this is such a diverse, your work, although there's what I call concentric circles of commonality. I just made that up.
I like it.
I like the alliteration.
Yes.
Something on it.
Okay. I thought. But when you really, you're so right, because it's so different. Your body of work, although common, but so uniquely different. Yeah. And that's one of the, that's also one of the things that really kind of charged me up. Tom, talk about how important it is to interact with the community that you're filming with, because you do a lot of on-site locations, and if you can just kind of talk about that.
Yeah, sure. Being an independent filmmaker, everybody should be aware of the budget constraints. It's not as easy as finding a location and paying for it and using it in your films. One thing that I've learned is that there are a lot of people that are part of your community that are really interested and impressed when they find out that you're a filmmaker and you're an artist, and they kind of want to be involved in that on some level. I find that it's important when you're going to shoot a film to never say never about what the possibilities are. I've been in touch. I live in the township of Bloomfield. I've been in contact with the council members, property owners there. I tell them what we're doing. I'm very open about the kind of films that we're making, and it really piques their interest. And more often than not, they're very willing to share their resources with filmmakers at great discounted prices. And it's something that's opened the doors for me, and it's actually made filmmaking a lot easier when you do that. I could give you an example. I know we've discussed previously the township of Branchville, New Jersey, and Mayor Anthony Fredo. I want to give him a shout out. But I reached out to him and explained to him what we were doing in his town. And just logistically, the town is about an hour from where I live. And so the people that I have influence over that I could have used for a scene where we needed a massive amount of extras, we needed about 45 to 60 people for a scene, it would have been logistically difficult to get 45 to 60 people from my location out to Branchville. I reached out to the mayor, and I went out on the Branchville community page on social media, on Facebook. I made them aware of what I was doing in their town, and Branchville turned out about 45 to 60 extras for us, and it saved me that trouble. And on top of that, they were playing protesters in a scene where they're protesting the mayor. Mayor Tony Fredo, gave him the part as the mayor in the town.
Oh, cool.
But the extras actually made their own protest signs.
Wow.
And that saved us a credible amount of trouble and creative input as far as making these signs, and they all came out, and just the best bunch of volunteers that you can have. It was an extremely hot day out there, and like people that had never been involved in filmmaking before, they were all extremely excited and willing to stand around for hours while we got the set together. And just incredibly helpful in spreading the word for us and promoting for us. A lot of those people that were there are now friends of mine, and they help us promote what we're doing in our work, And I think it's really important for filmmakers to understand that it's not something to be afraid of, and to go talk to your local politicians, go talk to your local business owners, and you will find locations and assistance from them that you might not have found if you just went on your own and just kind of, you know, settled with what you could afford and what your own resources are. There is a community out there.
We have young.
Yep.
We have young students here. Best piece of advice to give young students on the way up, because as Ralph Cramden said, you know what I'm going to say, because you're a honeymoon guy. Yeah, you be kind to the people you meet on the way up, because you meet the same kind of people on the way down. Yeah. Ed Norton said, it happens to be every day in the sewer.
Right.
So, oh well, I had to do that.
Well, I think the only piece of advice that I could give to anyone, I mean, really, who the hell am I anyway? But best piece of advice is to, you know, don't ever say that it's too late. Don't ever say I can't do this. You know, I've crested 50, and I made my first film, you know, when I turned 50.
I'd kill to be 50.
Yeah. So I mean, the thing is, it's like, you know, I know a lot of people who think, you know, it's too late for that. It's never too late. It's never too late, whether you're young or you're old or anything else. The only limitations that you have are what you put on yourself. So just get rid of those. Disavow yourself of that notion. There's stuff that's out there. People are going to judge it. There are going to be people who like things just because they like you. There are people who are going to hate things because they don't like you. It's going to be people who just don't like what you're doing because they don't agree with your politics or whatever. So what? You know, create for yourself. Trust that you have an interesting story to tell. Try to make it an interesting story, and then just do it. There's very little limitations nowadays. I mean, just about everybody has some sort of phone, an iPhone or an Android phone that has a 4K camera in it. So you shoot on your phone. So you get free software from the internet. You download it and you put it together. It doesn't have to be, you know, Final Cut Pro. It doesn't have to be After Effects. It doesn't have to be all the professional grade stuff. If you have an interesting story to tell and you put it out there, people will identify with it. So just do it. Yeah, mm-hmm. Just drop all the excuses. If you want to do it, do it. If you don't want to do it, stop making excuses and just go do something else.
Yeah. I love that. That's great.
Tom.
Yeah. just to touch on a few things that Keith said, I agree 100%. If you're a young filmmaker, don't be afraid to make a film. Don't be afraid to make a bad film. Don't look for perfection in your own work. I know people working on films did wrong. Making films is a learning process. I would never claim to call myself an amazing filmmaker, but I'm trying to get there someday. It is a learning process. Don't try to satisfy other people's vision of what your work should be. You really have to be true to yourself. You have to be true to the stories that you want to tell. There are a lot of outside influences, especially with the advent of social media now. We see a lot of amazingly talented people doing a lot of amazing things. Don't gauge your own success based upon that kind of stuff, because then you'll never get anywhere. Because, like my dad always told me, there's always somebody out there tougher than you. Well, there's always going to be somebody more talented, smarter, better looking, and you just can't let that get you down. You have to do your you do have to do your best to express yourself, follow your dreams. The ability is there. The doors are open for you to do it. We live in a world where you could become a YouTube star if the right person sees you singing on a video. It's amazing. So be true to yourself. Don't be afraid to fail. And don't be afraid to reach out to a handful of very close people. I know I have some in my life, including my wife and some friends that I turn to for advice and for their opinions on my work. And it's nice to have a close circle of friends that you could kind of lean on and whose opinions you respect, and that'll help you pursue your art. And I think no one should be afraid to do that.
It's funny you mentioned your dad, and when we sat down together, another piece of advice you said something to me, and I remembered this from months and months ago.
Yeah.
Your dad, you said to me, your dad had said something about the strength of a person is knowing when to walk away.
Yeah.
Didn't he say that?
Yeah.
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 And that just resonated with me.
Yeah.
Anyway, Stephanie.
I think from a more mainstream perspective, because I've worked on bigger productions as well, like as a script supervisor, I think at the beginning, when you have an opportunity, sometimes you do have to kind of fake it so you make it a little bit. And by that chance, by that I mean, don't hesitate and not jump into an opportunity because you feel like you're not prepared, because you could always learn as you go. And I think you're never fully prepared, but when you do have opportunities, you go in with a confidence that you got this while you keep asking questions and learning and observing. I think observing for me has been key because, you know, whether it's from another director that I've been able to work with or a writer or a producer, and just observing everything and then utilizing that. And each time you become more confident and you know a little bit more about what you're doing. I think that's part of it. And the other thing is when you do have like a story to tell on a more independent level, everyone has such a unique perspective. So don't be afraid somebody's done it before or somebody's already done that or why is mine important? Because everyone's unique. And I think if you have a drive to do something and you want to share something, nothing should stop you. You know.
Okay. So. Next little groupie
Love
thing
that.
Here
nice.
Is independent films. Some feelings about independent films. I'm a huge fan. I kind of mentioned, I think, to each one of you, I had certain visions of what the show would be about. But the beauty of independent films, as I've come to learn, that 35%. Of the filmmakers are women, as opposed to 3% in Hollywood. And then, if you could just make some comments about independent films, I talk about the future of independent films as I see it with the advent of Apple and Amazon and Netflix. Are there going to be more opportunities for you all, et cetera?
Stephanie.
Okay. Right,
sure.
Yeah.
I think probably the reason for more female directors in the independent world is because oftentimes in the independent world you have female writers that are also directing their own work, and it doesn't need to come from an executive or through a training program or et cetera. I think in the mainstream production world, people like to hire who they've already worked with and who is a sure shot. And so unfortunately, oftentimes the same, you know, directors right. get hired and female directors aren't always given the same chance.
Yeah.
But in the independent world, you're getting your own funding, you're making it yourself, so you don't have to be in the DGA necessarily, you know, so you have more opportunities to be able to express yourself creatively. But hopefully, you know, that's changing. And I think the reason I actually got into script supervising was because I wanted to be a director, but I wanted to know what I was doing first. I didn't want to go in and be one of those directors that give female directors a bad name because you don't know what you're doing. So I'm like, I need to be as prepared as possible because that's important. And I think the more prepared people are in general, male or female, you know, the more successful they're going to be as a director. So I think directing is so important because you're working with every department. So you really need to know what you're doing, not just your story. And so hopefully, you know, that will change with time the more.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd actually like to kind of jump off of something that Stephanie talked about, which is this idea of risk mitigation in when you get into like the larger world of cinema. I mean, you take a look at the majority of the films that come out today. I mean, I think Marvel is like on its, I don't know, 700th film. you know, and what happens is, you know, you have people that are focused on the business of show, and so what happens is they need to make sure that if they're going to be investing hundreds of millions of dollars into something, that there's going to be some sort of return on investment. Mm-hmm. So the golden age of being able to make films like, you know, The Godfather or The French Connection or anything else, you know, those have sort of gone away because there's not as much of a guaranteed return on the investment that's put out there. The nice thing about independent film is that you can actually see all these alternative stories that wouldn't get put out there. You're talking about 35% of filmmakers. Well, you know, the inclusion of others in the independent film world is significantly higher. The number of people of color that make films is significantly higher. The people who are in the LGBTQ plus, I think that's all of them now. Not to make light of it, aren't you? But even those stories, there's a significantly higher percentage of those stories getting made, because that risk mitigation isn't the first thing that comes to mind. The first thing that comes to mind is the story. It's about getting out the vision, the thoughts, the characters of people who are in all of these different sections of life. You don't see that. I mean, you hear the applause of, Black Panther because it's the first black superhero movie. Well, how far did we have to come before that happened? There's always those little things, this superhero might be gay. Why are we whispering that? Why is that even a big thing? It shouldn't be. Our entire world is an inclusive world, whether people want to admit it or not. You walk down the street, you're gonna walk past someone who's transsexual. You're gonna walk past someone who's a person of color. You're gonna walk past the woman. I mean, this stuff actually happens in real life, and it's not reflected on the screen as much as it should be. Independent film that's completely turned on its ear. Those are all the stories that you'll see. You'll see a story about Hasidic women that are trying to run away. You'll see things about a girl that posed as a boy for years in order to escape Nazi Germany. You'll see all this stuff, I mean, all these films, you will see things that you will not see in the mainstream media. That's the importance of independent film, because that's where real stories are happening. There's great movies that are coming out in the theaters, absolutely. But the thing is, you can actually look and say, oh, you know what? I've seen that movie before.
There's a stifling of creativity on that end, isn't there? Independent film is so much more creative.
But they also lose the heart. So, we were talking about Robert Wise before. So, The Day the Earth Stood Still, amazing film, one of my favorites,
Michael Rennie?
Yep. Now, they made a remake of it. Now, did the CGI and the big budget do it any better? No. Why? Well, some people said, it's a story, it's a stilted acting. No, it was the fact that it actually lost the heart and the soul. Because The Day the Earth Stood Still was not about a giant robot coming to Earth. It was not about some guy walking in here from the planet, whatever, right? It was about the fact that we were looking at how people react to the other. And that's what was lost. That's the story. It's not the robot. It's not the spaceship. It's about the fact that human
beings—they're trying to
beings,
help us.
Yeah,
they're trying to help us.
And human beings are against that. There's such a fear of the other that we're going to destroy ourselves because of it.
Right.
So
exactly.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't have too much to add, but the independent film community is really not tethered to the structure of Hollywood, and so that's why you see so much more creativity and openness in the indie film community. And I know when you mentioned 35% of female directors, I'm sure that percentage is very high in the independent horror community, because quite a number of female directors are in the independent horror community.
That's
and
so cool.
and they're very prevalent, and they're out there, and they're doing a lot of great work, and quite a few at the last convention I went to, the film festival, there was quite a few there that actually won awards for editing, directing, and such. So, I think that independent film is you're kind of outside those old practices and the old acceptance, and we just seem to be a lot more open to acceptance of everyone, and of course there's a certain quality that everybody looks for. It's not just, well, if a female director makes a bad film, it's a good film because it's a female director. That's not how it works, but I think it definitely works where there are no preconceived notions in the independent film community, or at least a lot less, and it makes it...
It's a special place.
It's a special place,
yeah.
And it's a lot more diverse, and there's a lot more freedom to express your vision the way that it should be seen, as opposed to the way that might make more money.
It's a wonderful... For the young people here, it's a wonderful platform and a wonderful place to go, because it's forever changing and expanding and growing.
Yeah.
I think, because I watched time, why don't you throw one of our...
Okay.
You throw one of your fun, and
Before
I'll throw one
of
my...
Before we do the fun questions, I just feel like everybody needs to know where to find
their
information.
Perfect.
If they want to watch their shows.
It's called
all
Contact.
The shows they've made films. So, you can start.
So my Angelight Films, which are the kids I make with the films I make with the kids with brain tumors can be found on my website, which is angelightfilms.org. That's with one L. And under the film section. And then the documentary information for Tati the Documentary, it's Tati, T-A-T-I, thedocumentary.com. And on that, we also have a GoFundMe page, which is a link to that and a link to our trailer. And my IMDb page, Stephanie Angel, has the feature film I recently co-directed and some of my other work that I've done.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Great, yeah. I can be found at on social media under Thomas Ryan. Our website is theaterofterror.net. That's theater spelled T-H-E-A-T-R-E.
The right way.
But our films can be found on there. You can also watch my first feature film, Faces. It's free on Amazon Prime, if you're a member. You have to search Faces, space, Tom Ryan, because for some reason it won't come up for any for anyone that just searches Faces. But yeah, all of our work can be found there. We have a social media page as well under Theater of Terror. And I heavily promote the company, so it shouldn't be too hard to find us.
Okay, and you can find me on social media as well by searching Keith Armonaitis. I'll spell that for everyone. So it's ARMONAITIS. You know, we've also got a Facebook page for Be Home Soon movie, which is for that one. And then we have one for Swung and for Mist as well. But by searching for my name, all of those will pop up.
If folks out there want to go to njdiscover.com, there's an article, all your articles are there, all the interviews are there. And
the correct spelling of my last name.
I've been correct, by the way, all the time. And I oscillate. I'm just confused whether it's Tom or Thomas. Whatever. Yeah. But you go to njdiscover, there's a promo article which has the links to all your interviews, so it's all there. Mm. So, jump in.
Okay. Yeah, we have some fun questions. But you already told them some of these.
Well, I have a new one.
All right, do the new one.
I have a new one.
So
this is fun stuff in the few minutes that we have left. Keith. I just like saying Keith. I don't know.
I like it, too. I like hearing it.
This is new. You haven't even heard this one
before. No, I don't think I have.
No, this is new. So, who would you like to be stuck in an elevator with?
Oh, my God.
For how long? That would be the question.
I don't know. However long it takes to fix it. This is New York City. It could be all day.
Oh, and it could be anybody from anywhere, anytime.
Yeah,
anything.
Living, it could be living or dead. It doesn't.
I wouldn't want to be stuck in an elevator with a dead person. That would just, after, especially if it went on.
Well,
for
they're reincarnated.
Yeah, so
don't get technical.
I'm being facetious. You know me. Yeah. So, that's always a tough question because it's always. I mean, there are so many different things. I mean, you know, there's the geeky tech side of me that would love to be caught in an elevator with Steve Jobs, though I think he would probably not be as nice as I would hope.
Correct.
You know, I always talk about wanting to talk to Bobby Kennedy because I really think that that America kind of lost its soul. And I'm also, I feel a kinship with him because I was born the same year that he passed.
Wow.
You know, that he was killed. So,
wow.
Yeah, it was quite an upheaval that year. So,
68. So, you're a 68 guy.
Yeah. Huh. So Martin Luther King,
yeah,
Bobby
sure.
Kennedy. So, that's probably the two sides. You know, in terms of filmmaking, I don't know. I probably would want to talk to. I would probably like to talk to Robert Wise or Rod Serling. Actually, you know what? Let me just say it. Rod Serling.
That's
I'd love to get stuck in an elevator with Rod Serling.
Yeah, that would be fun.
Which is, it kind of reminds me, the most impactful Twilight Zone was when Burgess Meredith, the librarian, gets stuck in a vault.
Time enough at last.
Yeah,
yes.
And he was estranged from his wife because he just loved to read. And the world ends. And he has a billion books to read, and he's the only person left in the world, mm-hmm. and he breaks his glasses.
That comeuppance was just wrong. I think that should have. Yeah, I know it makes for good theater, but that was. I think that was just the one ending that they should have changed.
Okay, all right.
They should have given it.
We
to
can
him.
Talk about that later. Yeah. Tom,
the elevator repairman. Hopefully, all right.
But anyway, that's brilliant.
What are you doing in here?
Brilliant. I never thought of that.
I guess there's a couple of people that come to mind. Like Keith said, there's a million people. And we discussed this when you asked me, like, favorite filmmaker. I don't know. I love so many different filmmakers and actors. I think it would be a lot of fun to get caught in an elevator with Vincent Price.
Right.
Or David Cronenberg. Cronenberg, I'm sorry. I find both of them kind of fascinating. I find a lot of guys, actors and directors and staples of the industry fascinating. You know, John Carpenter is another one I would love to talk to. Steven Spielberg, I'd love to talk to. Martin Scorsese, any of those guys, I'd love to get stuck in an elevator and just talk shop a little bit. I was actually in the elevator with Mick Garris this past weekend.
Wow.
Briefly, and I got to tell him a little bit about my anthology, and he got to tell me about his new anthology.
You weren't stuck in there, were
we? We weren't stuck in there, no. We went about seven floors together. It was very brief, but he was a real gentleman, and I wish we got stuck in the elevator so I could have pried some more information out of him, but yeah.
Okay.
I really don't want to get stuck in an elevator. Okay. Can I get another question? Well, if I was stuck in an elevator, I don't know if I'd really have an in-depth conversation except for how we're going to get out of here. But if it could be people that passed away as well, I think I would want to be stuck in an elevator with my sister that passed away so that we could have a moment together again.
Okay. Wow. Beautiful.
Tom, you said, you mentioned Vincent Price, just to give you the power of your genre. Oh.
We're getting the 2 minutes.
Oh, 2 minutes. So, in the 50s, Vincent Price was in a movie called House of Wax.
Sure.
And to this day.
In 3D?
And to this day, we're talking 60 years later. That movie, and every once in a while it's on, and all, it scares the living hell out of me.
Yeah.
It's impacted me, and I don't know if I have to see, you know, like a psychologist to talk about that, but it just petrifies.
It's a great concept. It's a frightening concept.
Frightening, so, yeah. what he did.
Absolutely.
We're getting to 1 minute now.
All right, so this is that one one finger, 1 minute.
Thank you so much for being on our show.
This was great.
Well,
thank
you.
Not enough time.
I think it's really helped a lot of filmmakers.
I hope.
Young
as
people.
I look at our youth out there.
A lot of inspiration.
Our youth, our future.
Here. Yeah.
To kind of learn from people pretty close to your generation.
Yeah. Just go do.
Yeah. It's funny. You said, you touched on it's never too, never too old. You know, I began my whole career at 65.
And we're wrapping it
so
up.
So we're wrapping it up.
Right. Thank you so much for watching the show.
This has been great.
Really. Will we be back soon?
Well, we're always back soon. We'll figure it out. All right. We're back.
Go to the website and see you next time.
Yes.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.